The RV Show USA is brought to you by Rockwood, building better RVs, making smarter RVers.
All right, a few weeks back, we had some first-time guests on the show, and they caused quite a stir in terms of how much they say that they budget every single month to sustain their lifestyle as full-time RVers. Seems that some people say that, man, these guys must be rich. To dig a little bit deeper and get a better understanding of the need to properly budget yourself for a lifestyle of full-time RVing, let's run over to Florida. Mark and Sue Chandler, long time no talk with y'all.
Hi, Alan.
Howdy. So I had no idea that a short little aside in our conversation last time about how much it costs to live full-time in an RV would cause such a get so much attention. Tell folks what we did, what we're talking about.
Well, it's a really tough subject to talk about real quick, Alan, and that's why we appreciated when you referred to our channel so that people can actually order our spreadsheet that has every single detail we're talking about on now, and they can exclude or include things as need be. I want to blurt out two things. Last time we were talking, I think what caused a stir was when we told everybody we go through $6,800 per month on our style of RVing. And that includes literally everything. That's every plug nickel we spend. So, of course, there's lots of personal things in there. Today, we can talk about the bare minimum number, and if we want to talk about a bare minimum number, let's call it $3,500 per month. And that $3,500 for us, for our style, remember, we're tourists. We travel to different places that we want to go, and then we park ourselves for a week or two or three or four, and we just travel around and do things that we want to do. But even at that, realizing that we are not upside down on a rig because we own it outright. Our tow vehicle is owned outright. So when I say $3,500 a month, that doesn't even include any payments for any equipment.
Or a house. When we started full timing, we got rid of our house, and we don't have any storage costs involved either.
Let me ask you this, guys. Before you became full-timers, and I know it was you went full-time almost 2 years ago, something like that?
Almost 3.
Okay, 3 years ago. So you planned things out. Are you pretty much on target where you thought you were going to be in terms of expenses, or were you very far off? Tell me about that whole deal.
Alan, I have to be honest with you. RVing was the furthest from our mind. We knew that we had planned for a retirement. We just did not know what it was. We didn't know if it was sitting in the home that we owned or if it was going to be vacationing for 3 or 4 months, you know, to get out of the cold, if we were going to be on a cruise ship. We didn't have a clue.
But we were planning for retirement, so we were saving money.
Right. And, you know, one of the criticisms that we get on the channel, and we're so thankful we have such a great audience. I mean, we have hardly any trollers that jump on us on the amount we spend, and maybe it's because they feel sorry for Sue that she's stuck with me. You know?
But well, we may try to drum you up a few trollers off this show, Mark.
So yeah, yeah. But the few people that have said anything talking about the costs, I guess we kind of planned on our retirement, and by us wrapping up our stick and brick life, there's a big portion of those costs that can be rolled forward and used to our adventure here, so to speak. And really, we look at the extra costs that we're rolling through now as just kind of a delta or an adder onto the normal life that we had, realizing that we think we get a lot of extra value for the abnormalness that we've added to it by being able to be involved in the RV here thing. You talked about doing homework and trying to make sure you buy the right vehicle. Your guest right before us said something that was kind of important. If you can at all try to avoid buying the wrong vehicle the first time, some people buy the wrong thing the second time.
Yes.
Every single time you switch equipment, that's when you take your bath. You know, Sue and I are fully aware that we're going to take our bath somewhere down the road. We're going to take an 8% hit per year on a $230,000 motorhome that we have. And yet we are so happy on the selection that we made. We truly did buy our last RV first, and all we got to do is keep Humpty Dumpty together.
Right? So, but let's go back to the beginning. You had to go into this knowing it's going to cost you X amount per month. A range of how much it's going to cost you per month. Are you telling me that you didn't do that? You just kind of were winging it?
Well, I had a friend actually that kept asking me why I wasn't retiring. When we would talk about 401ks and pensions and things, and I kind of outlined with her where I thought I was, you know, from a financial standpoint, and she'd just look at me like almost, you know, verbally slapping me upside the back of my head, and she'd say, well, how long do you think you're going to live, and how come you're not doing something here? So I went back home and, you know, just did a real cursory analysis, and I started to be amazed that if I wrapped up some of my stick and brick costs and we would do something different, I started to agree with her that based on Sue and I just being working stiffs, that fortunately we had pensions and two social securities like everybody else on the planet, you know, as long as you paid into it. Mm-hmm. And then the fact that we took our 401k funding very serious back since the mid-80s, we had a good, solid financial plan. So it was at that time when we saw the money that we had to work with, we could start doing what-if scenarios, you know, what do we want to do? And then we started going to RV shows, and we started looking at pull-behinds.
Mark is a researcher. He did a lot of research online, looking at YouTube channels from other people that were full-time. And we didn't really find anybody that had a spreadsheet like what we have, what we're putting out there. Mm-hmm. So we were kind of guesstimating a lot. We're looking at different RV parks, how much would it cost to be there a month, and, you know, that sort of thing. So we're kind of balancing, like, well, if we're not paying our taxes on the house anymore, that money can go towards, you know, fill in the blank. So we did do some kind of figuring out what it would cost above and beyond, besides our groceries and our usual expenses.
Talk to me for a second about the, I've heard you use the term the high water mark, talk to me about that, about using the high water mark in terms of expenses, how important that is and why.
Well, I think if I'm understanding your question, Alan, high water mark is, you know, if the water gets too high, you can die. And the high water mark is when things go wrong. You wish it didn't, but it did. And if you can't bail yourself out a number of times when you have expenses that exceed your likes or your wishes, your whole RVing experience is going to get harder and harder, and it's going to get more and more sour. And you as a couple in such a small space, you have to both be on board and happy with what's happening. We, fortunately, with our 401k savings, we have enough of a backup plan that when we get a flat tire, and flat tires on a big motorhome typically end up where you have to replace the tire. You know, you very infrequently are in a situation where you patch it. Mm. So every flat tire costs you $900. Well, you know, you have two flats in 3 years, you're $1,800 out. And that's a small example of some of the things that can happen.
Okay,
yeah,
listen, guys, we're going to run out of time, but I know that you've got this spreadsheet that you're allowing people to download. If we send them to your YouTube channel to follow you know, our journey in Myles, are they able to connect with you that way?
Absolutely.
Right. I will not you know, put this on a list or anything. They literally put in the subject line, cost sheet, send it to ourjourneyinmiles@gmail.com. Myles is spelled M-Y-L-E-S. And I will send them a 46-line spreadsheet with every single thing on there. They can
fill in as they go. Listen, guys, we got to leave it there. Thanks so much. I do appreciate it. We'll talk again. Folks, my biggest takeaway to what Mark and Sue said is that it's best to estimate on the high side of costs instead of the low side, always. Otherwise, you could be in for a very, very, very bad situation, and we don't want that. Connect with Mark and Sue on YouTube, Our Journey in Myles, M-Y-L-E-S. Back with more after this.